Good morning. I want to welcome you to the opportunity to worship today. Yes, you are not in the church, but we can worship God anywhere we are. So when we will be playing music, you'll have the words that you'll be able to see and sing along. I just also want to thank each person here today with the audio, video, the piano, the organ, also the leading of the music. I want to thank each one of the people here today, because I've heard from numerous people how important it is in these difficult times that we're going through, and having people help us connect to God, and what a blessing that is. So I want to welcome you. I also want to say God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. But not only is God is good all the time, but God is able. Even in these difficult situations that we're in, God is able. Also on our announcements today, the only meeting that we'll have will be Thursday, March the 26th at 6:30. It'll be more of a technology meeting. It'll be Zoom and other electronic ways that we'll be able, but the education team will be meeting electronically. And also, I want to mention both of the churches I serve here in Ellsworth and Kannapolis, because we do have a need for, because we will always have financial needs. Also, UMCOR, that's United Methodist, where we use those funds, and it helps people in need and tragedies, and that is such a blessing, because when you give to that today, that we give to that, it actually all goes to the need, because that takes care of the administrative part of it. So throughout the year, when you give money to UMCOR, that $1 goes, exactly $1 goes where you ask for it to go to. So our address for, if you want to send a check, would be 402 North Douglas here in Ellsworth, or in Kannapolis, you would send it to Ellen Russell, 111 East 1st in Kannapolis, Kansas. So at this time, I'm going to start out to center ourselves, and then we'll go to call to worship. But I'm going to come here, as I do each and every week, and I'm going to ask you to center yourselves before God. I'm going to ask you to bow your head, but also open your hands, your hearts, and your minds. Let us go to God. Good morning, Lord. We thank you and praise you for this day. We thank you and praise you for the opportunity to worship you and praise you. No matter where we're at, we can always worship you. So minister to each and every heart today. Because, dear Lord, I know we're carrying a lot of anxiety. The things that we're used to doing, we're not able to do. Whether it's going to school, whether it's going to go to restaurants or any entertainment or any of those things. Dear Lord, it isn't the same. But one thing is the same, is you always love us. You always have and you always will. And dear Lord, that we're not walking and carrying this alone. We're not even meant to carry it. You tell us to come to you 700 times. So I pray that each one of us would allow you to work, that the Holy Spirit would loosen the grips of things we're so tightly holding on to, and that we would truly surrender. Lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is not limited. Now we all have empty open hands to receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We all have empty open hands to receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. And dear Lord, you're calling on us to make a difference in a world that is hurting, in a world that has so much anxiety, that we would continually to love, that we would continually to pray, that we would continually to forgive. I just thank you and praise you for all of this. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. At this time, we'll have our call to worship. Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. You are good, and what you do is good. Teach me your decrees. Though the arrogant have smeared me with lies, I keep your precepts with all my heart.
Their hearts are callous and unfeeling, but I delight in your law.
It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. The law of your mouth
is better to me than thousands of coins of gold and silver.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you today. I thank you for this opportunity to broadcast, to share your good news for each person that is helping to pull this off, but also for each person that is listening, that is watching. Dear Lord, just draw us all closer to you, that we would come before you and know that we are loved, know that we are forgiven. And even in these difficult situations, we are not alone. You are with us. Dear Lord, I also pray for a revival. A revival, dear Lord, that starts within. That we would draw closer to you and we draw closer to our families. That, dear Lord, that we may not be able to have that physical contact, but we can even call people that are shut in, that need to hear from us, to need to hear encouragement of your word. So minister to each and every heart. We thank you again for this opportunity. We thank you for forgiving us, dear Lord, by what Christ has done on that cross for us. Not only did Jesus defeat sin, but he also defeated death. Because in 3 days he arose again and was with many people for 40 days and then ascended into heaven and is interceding for each one of us. We thank you and praise you for that. And what a blessing that is. Now, gracious God, we come before you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And I pray as we say the Lord's Prayer that by your Spirit we live out each word as we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thy is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Now at this time, we will be singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus, and you'll see that on the screen. this time I'll be speaking to the young disciples. And today I'd like to share with you about God's word from Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. God tells us, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Now, starting Monday, because you guys have had spring break, we had the opportunity to, you won't be at school, but you'll be learning. You'll be learning, and your parents will be helping you. And it is going to be different. But you know what? God's going to use this in mighty ways. God's going to use this to draw us closer to each other, closer to God and closer to our brothers and sisters, our moms and dads. And that's going to be such a blessing. I was watching TV yesterday, and I think it was a Pillsbury commercial. And it was about baking biscuits. But they said, as a family, we have 37 minutes together. Well, I know we're going to have more time than that now because of the virus and the outbreak. We won't have school, but we'll be with our parents more. We'll be with our brothers and sisters more. And I know God's going to use that because God loves us. God wants us to love Him, and He wants us to love each other. So at this time, I want to have you bow your heads and pray with me. Gracious God, Your ways and Your thoughts are so much greater than ours. For some, we're frightened, we're worried. But we know, Lord, that You can do all things, and all things are possible. And dear Lord, we just pray that we would all grow closer to You, that we would think more of You and spend time with You, and spend time with our families. And to be with each other. And what a blessing that's going to be. We thank You and praise You. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now we'll be singing "Jesus Loves the Little Children." At this time, we'll have a praise hymn. Through it all, we'll be singing this two times. Through it all.
I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned.
At this time, we're going to have a prayer for our offering. And I just, as always, want you prayerfully consider your giving, knowing that it is needed, that God is going to use it in many ways to further the kingdom, to help us take care of things. So let us go, Lord, in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity to give, because we know that all good things come from heaven above. We ask that you bless this offering that we'll be receiving here at the church, at the office at 402 North Douglas, that they can mail in their offerings, their tithes, their offerings, and also giving for UMCOR. Or in Kannapolis, they can send it to Ellen Russell at 111 East 1st in Kannapolis. So gracious God, we just thank you, knowing that you're going to be working in mighty ways, knowing that people are still going to hear the gospel, knowing that through it all, even in difficult times, you are there. You never leave. You never forsake. And this is an opportunity, dear Lord, as we work with you and serve with you. I just thank you and praise you. Not only you'll bless the offering, but you'll bless each one as we carry on and help others. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now at this time, we'll have the scripture reading. First from 1 Peter chapter 4, 12 and 13, and then from Romans 8, 17. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's suffering, so that you may be also glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. And in Romans 8, 17, and if children then, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you today. And dear Lord, I pray that you would give me your words as we reflect on our life as a plan. Many times we may feel that there's no plan at all, but there is, and you are faithful. So I just pray that you would give me the words today, that we'd have interpretation, application of your words for our life, because your words never return void. I just ask that you would hide me behind the cross of Jesus so they'd see Jesus and not me. In Jesus' precious name, amen. We've been doing a sermon series called The Easter Experience with the Sunday school classes here in Ellsworth, and it's been the same message in Kannapolis and also in Ellsworth. And today is My Life Has a Plan. And from that film, it showed Mary and all that Mary went through. And they already had showed the scourging, but at this time, what was taking place was Jesus walking to Golgotha. And the pain and the suffering, not only Jesus felt, but Mary, his mother, was feeling. And there would also be flashbacks of different things in her life, from Mary's life, from pregnancy to Jesus' crucifixion. From Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, to a town of Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." And Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who also said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." And then Mary said, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. You know, when Mary heard this as a teenager, I imagine it would have been so difficult. But she did hear the words of Gabriel, "For nothing is impossible with God." And in Isaiah 55, 8 and 9, as I shared with the children, this would have been written about 740 years before Mary had heard this from Gabriel. "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." And I want us to hold on to this, because throughout this time, that what is Mary is experiencing, I know it would have been difficult. I know it would have been hard to comprehend. But God's thoughts and ways are so much higher than ours. In Jeremiah 29, 11 through 14, this was shared with the Jewish people. They were about to go into exile. This would have been about 600 years before Mary. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile." You see, God has a plan for each one of us. A plan to prosper us and not to harm us. And plans to give you hope and a future. Many times, in difficult times, it's hard to see that. I know it had been very difficult for Mary to witness what was happening to her son. But this wasn't new to Mary. things weren't always easy for Mary. Just 30 days after Jesus was born, in Luke chapter 2, it was a time of purification. And after Jesus was born, they met Simon. He would have been a man of anywhere from 90 to over 120 years old. But he had been told by God that he would get to see the Messiah. He would have the opportunity before he passed. So he was led by God. He is led by the Holy Spirit. And when he sees this couple, he's being nudged by the Spirit that this is the one. This is the one that is the Messiah. This is the Savior. And Simon asks to take Jesus, the child, into his arms. And he prays God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now may dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all your people. A light of revelation for the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel." The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." Imagine what was going on when Jesus was struggling to go to Calvary. Her heart was being pierced again, thinking what Simeon had said. And probably within a year, year and a half of this time, after Simeon, the wise men had come from the east to worship the one that they had been waiting for, the Messiah. And they'd given gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But very shortly after this, the Joseph of Mary and baby Jesus had to flee. They had to escape to Egypt because Herod wanted to kill all the little boys of ages of 2 and under in Bethlehem. But because what the wise men had given them, they were able to take this journey and even start a new home in Egypt until it was time to come back again. You see, here is God's plans. Here is God's purpose. It's so much greater than ours. And at that time, I imagine it would have been very difficult. But God was providing a way again for them. And now what she was witnessing. Her son was beaten beyond recognition. Hearing the crowds yelling, "Crucify him, crucify him." Hearing, watching him trying to carry this beam that would have weighed between 75 and 120 pounds. And the very thing that was happening was actually written in Psalm 22, 1,000 years before. He was despised and rejected by men. Excuse me, I'm reading Isaiah right now, and that was 700 years, but Psalm 22 also had very many of these very same things. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced by our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was like a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before his shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And he who can speak of his descendants, for he was cut off from the land of the living, for the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer, and through the Lord make his life a guilt offering. He will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. And after the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, by righteousness, the servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Why does God allow suffering? Persecution. Why does God allow suffering? Early in the letter that I read in 1 Peter, discussed one of the possible responses to persecution, to suffering, is to give oneself over to the will of God. We saw Jesus do that in the garden. Not my will, but thy will. Not my will, but thy will be done. Now he turns to two other possibilities. First, believers may think that they are being singled out and wonder why something is happening. Yet suffering should be expected for those who follow Christ. In Matthew 5, 11 and 12, from the Beatitudes, verse 11. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And then also the disciples in Acts chapter 5, verses 41 and 42. The apostles left the Sanhedrin, rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. That is Jesus' name. Day after day, in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Christ. Even though that they said you had to stop, they wouldn't stop, because they knew they were being worthy, because, yes, they had been persecuted, but the hope that they were giving, the hope that they were giving was transforming lives. People were coming to Christ. Second, Christians may think that they're being judged for some reasons. But if they are living above approach, they can rejoice that they are suffering according to God's will and for his glory. They can also stand firm in trusting the outcome to God as they continue to do what is right. in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7. Endure the hardships as discipline. God is treating you as his child. For what children are not disciplined by their father? And how God can use the suffering. How God can use this persecution. So God uses suffering. First is to train us in obedience. During the days of Jesus, in Hebrews 7 and verse 8. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of the reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. This is the perfect high priest, one without any sin, and is praying for us, lifting up prayers even today for each one of us, for what we're going through. God is there. Jesus is there for us. And in that suffering, God uses suffering to produce patience. In Romans 5:3, not only so, but also glory in sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. God can use this because God works in us and through us, even in difficult situations, because of it, by the working of the Holy Spirit. It gives us perseverance that we continually to march on, continually to do the will of God. And in that perseverance, it builds us, our character. And in that character, it gives us hope. Because it's transforming us and making us more like our Savior, Jesus. Making us more like Jesus. It is also to prevent pride. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 and 9, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. You see, Apostle Paul got to see a bit of heaven. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast in all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me." Because when we are weak and we rely on God, how much more can be done? How much more can be done? Also, God uses suffering to teach his ways. In Psalm 119, 65 through 71. And we used most of this for the call to worship. "Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands." I can trust your commands. "Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. You are good. And what you do is good. Teach me your decrees. Though the arrogant have smeared me with lies, I keep your precepts with all my heart. Their hearts are calloused and unfeeling, but I delight in your law." I delight in your law. "It was good for me to be afflicted, so that I might learn your decrees." You hear that? The psalmist even said, it was good. This was David, to even be afflicted, because then my focus, even in my suffering, I could focus on your word and allow your word to transform me, to allow me to look at what is really important. And then also God uses suffering to prepare us to comfort others. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts all of us in our troubles, so that we can comfort those in trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. Because in that suffering, it shows us comforting us. And when someone else is going through difficult times, we can comfort them. Now, I know we are now, we can't get out like we normally could. And I know things are different. But we can comfort others by email. We can comfort others by talking on the phone, lifting them up in prayer, and letting them know that they're not alone. And God can use all things for good. I believe God is going to use this time to draw us closer to Him and closer to one another. We'll be starting a new ministry called Congregational Care Ministry, but we won't be visiting for a while, but we will have names, and people can give me a call at the office or email, and I can give you numbers for so you can contact people, that you can pray for people, and let them know that you are thinking of them. Let them know how much God loves them, especially in these difficult times that we're going through right now. God uses suffering also to prove us. In 1 Peter 4:14, if you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of God and of God rest on you. What Peter is saying, God's going to help you. If you are insulted, it's okay, because you are blessed and God's going to use it in a mighty way, and God can use that to draw us all closer together. We've talked about why God allows suffering to happen. We've talked about how God uses suffering. And the name of this message is My Life Has a Purpose. I go back to Mary again and the hurt and the pain that she was suffering. It had to be so difficult. I can't even imagine. But one thing I noticed about Mary, no matter what was going on and how difficult it was, she was always close to Jesus. Last week we talked about how the disciples betrayed Him, how they abandoned Him, how they denied Him. But His mother is next to Him. Yes, she is in pain and agony, and at this time probably doesn't understand God's ways and God's thinking at this time, even though it was even in God's word 1,000 years before. All that was going on was already told. But what I draw from Mary is she still stayed close to Jesus. She was right there at His feet. In John, Jesus even looked at her hanging from the cross as the disciple John was with her. He said, "Woman, this is your son. Son, this is your mother. Take care of her." Even in his dying moments, Jesus was even thinking of his mother. And that we all need, especially in our sufferings, especially in difficult times, to stay close to Jesus. And because of that, because of the Easter experience, yes, He died on the cross. Yes, He died for His sins, but in 3 days He arose. And because of that, we have such hope. Because of that, we know that God has a plan for us. to share that hope with others, to let others know that God loves them, that God forgives them, and God desires a relationship with them. And in this time of need, please stay close to Jesus. Let us pray. Gracious God, I thank you and praise you. Many times in this suffering, we want to say, oh God, get me out of this. But dear Lord, help us by your Spirit say, God, what do you want me to learn from this? God, how do you want to use this to not only draw me closer to you, but use this that others be drawn closer to you by the way that I live, by the way that I respond. Dear Lord, I thank you and praise you. And dear Lord, that we would also be like Mary, that we would be close to you, dear Lord. Always draw closer to you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now at this time, we'll be singing our last hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, and you'll find that on the screen. Gracious God, I just thank you and praise you for the opportunity to worship you, for the opportunity to praise you. Dear Lord, we can worship and praise you wherever we are. I pray that each and every one felt your presence today. And know that even in suffering, in persecution, how you can use that, dear Lord, to draw us closer to you, to be more like Jesus, and that we would share that with others. Even in difficult times, you are able. Even in difficult times, you are there. So, gracious God, I just send them out today, that they would share your love and your grace through the power of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.